I was always very modest, really didn't think of myself as being particularly smart or unusual. I just thought I was more interested in certain topics than other people, but that sometimes I find a technical subject just becomes absolutely fascinating to me. I can't think about anything else. When you learn a new computer technology, you can immediately put it to work by writing software and be able to do things you couldn't do before. That I'm amazingly productive during these times. I can write amount of software programs that would take a normal person months and months to write, and I can just do it in a few days because I'm so excited and driven and obsessed with it. It's always been something unique that I've had. That was a lot of what has made me decide to work with computers, because that is what I have done throughout my career.
The misfits.
Not the status quo.
This is.
Thriller Lightning.
Yeah, it was a great hangout. I mean, you know, we got to talk about a lot of things. I feel like Keyan's an exceptional dude, man. Like, there's a reason why, you know, lightning developers are considered like these cutting edge geniuses, man. And just by talking to him for, you know, the span of like 4 hours, you clearly see that. Like, yeah, it's no wonder. Like, it's no wonder. And what an exceptional guy. Like, yeah, no doubt in my mind he's building the future. No doubt in my mind he's going to be completely successful in whatever he's doing. No doubt in my mind Stacker News is going to change the way we consume the internet. No doubt in my mind, lightning is the future.
Something about Bitcoin generally, it has a very weird feeling to it. When you get involved, I mean, I don't know what it is, but there's like an inevitability that you feel. When I was at this meetup, there were people. It just felt like we were on the edge of something. We were being we were being subversive. And people there were misfits in the best way. Like, I consider myself a misfit, and I felt like I was among misfits of their own kind. And it felt like we were doing something that was important, that certain people wouldn't want us to do. And there's something so cool about that. And I think it has to feel like what the early internet felt like. You have this pattern matching where you're like, this is what something important probably feels like. Like, I've read enough about the early internet and early computers to know that's how these people felt. And I started feeling this way about Bitcoin.
What did you do as a kid? Like, were you like into video games? Were you like always playing outside with friends, or were you?
I play sports. So
really?
I played a lot of sports. Yeah. So we were, actually played a lot of, we lived in the Bay Area in Sunnyvale. My dad worked he did like maintenance for a semiconductor company, like where he like repaired the machine. So it's kind of like a blue collar job and like a white collar industry. So I was in the Bay Area and I was playing all kinds of sports just all the time. And, eventually I got around to playing both baseball and football. And, we were good. We were like really good. So our football team, I think when I was 10 or 11, came in second place nationally. Our Pop Warner team. And the baseball team that I was playing for, we won nationally the following year, although I didn't play because I broke my ankle. So there was a lot of that. And I was actually very materialistic as a kid. I saw how, I perhaps got somewhat of a glimpse of like how pointless that was early. And it allowed me to maybe see past it a little bit later. But and then my parents went through like a divorce and like a bankruptcy, and then I moved kind of out into the Central Valley of California. And we don't have to go too far into this, but I didn't graduate from high school, and then I was like a grocery clerk for a while, and I lived in a Mexican restaurant, or behind a Mexican restaurant in a motel.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah.
When did you get into computers then? Were you like always into computers?
No. I was like a bad kid. Like I would, I didn't go to school.
Because you're hanging out with Mexicans? Or?
No, of course not.
I'm just kidding. That's like a joke for me.
Yeah, of course.
But I'm Mexican.
Yeah, I know. But
But why do you say you're a bad kid though?
I was like trying to be a cool kid.
Like, oh, so you were just like looking for attention or something?
Not attention, but I was like, I didn't know. I was like,
Were you like graffitiing?
I didn't know how much of a nerd I was yet.
Which nerd you were?
I didn't know that I actually preferred like more intellectual things because I was like kind of conditioned through all of the sports.
Gotcha.
To try to be a jock, kind of cool kid. And no one had really, my parents weren't very intellectual. They had their stuff. Mm-hmm. And so I thought I was supposed to be, not be a nerd.
Yeah. And you were going towards this direction of like, hey, go play sports, go do this, go do that, kind of be manly kind of thing. And you had never gotten a chance to like say, hey, go read this book or go be creative or go do this. And then when you finally started doing that, you're like, oh, actually enjoy this a lot more.
Yeah. Like I would read a lot when I was in high school. At this point, I stopped playing sports in high school at like after sophomore year. I had so many accumulated injuries over the years that I couldn't really play anymore. So
But I would like read a lot, and I liked, and I would occasionally get like very good grades, and this would disturb the teachers a lot because I would like test into higher level courses, but I was like failing all of my classes and stuff because I just wouldn't go and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was a, I didn't really realize that although I had signals earlier that, you know, I didn't really get, even though I was playing sports with these people, I didn't really get along with them. I was kind of a different kind of kid. I was kind of excluded from the group there. But I never felt like I got along too well with them. Anyway, but yeah, didn't graduate from high school. And then I went through this period of like, I don't know, like upheaval. Like I felt like I needed something to change. I actually, you mentioned graffiti, which is kind of weird, but I'd actually went through a period of doing a lot of graffiti.
Like, did you have your own tag and stuff?
Yeah, I had, my symbol is a green apple. So like on my Twitter, there's like a green apple next to my name.
Oh, is that why there's a green apple? I thought, okay, so that's weird because when I saw that green apple, I was like, that has to mean something.
Yeah.
But that's just the artistic guy in me.
Yeah, it does. I mean, it kind of does. It was kind of random. My first tag was this green, was a green apple that I did on the side of like an abandoned building. And after that point, I just kept doing it. But I got very kind of reckless and I started doing like bouldering type graffiti where I was climbing.
Badass, bro.
I was climbing water towers, climbing up onto billboards. Like for a period of time, I lived in Merced, California. It's like in the Central Valley. There was an IMF. Banker on a billboard, and I did a giant green apple over his face. So this is like, yeah. I eventually stopped doing that. That was maybe like a year or two. But after that, I was like, all right, I'm gonna go back to school. I don't know what I'm gonna go back to school for. Maybe pre-med. They had me take a computer class as like the recs, and they mentioned AI in this computer class, and then I was just enamored with the potential of computers. And I was very like math focused in high school. I always got really good grades in math and was like top of my class in math. But I was programming calculators back then, but I didn't realize they were actually programs. I thought they were just like, I thought it was just math because it was on a calculator. And then, I saw this potential for computers in this class I took and I was like, oh, it kind of connected the dots for me that, like maybe I also have a penchant for this kind of thing because I'd already been doing it and I had this like just serious interest in it. And then it also turned out later that it was like valuable. I didn't realize that even when anyone cared about, I was just like, I hope I can get out of college and get like a teacher salary. But then I had like friends do like internships at like Google and stuff. And they're like, yeah, I'm getting paid like this much money. And I'm only an intern. I'm not even really doing anything. And they're just like paying you, you know, they're paying them like, you know, $45,000 for a summer. And it's like, it's to prepare them for, or to set their expectations for what they'll eventually be making. And it was why, I mean, at that point I was taking design classes cause I'm kind of like, I kind of like aesthetics, but, yeah, I'd heard they were telling me that, and I was like, "Wow, that's awesome!" Like, I made an emotional decision to study computer programming because I just love it. There was something that clicked with me, but then it turned out to be lucrative.
That's awesome. That's such a great story. That's weird how you were like literally living behind this Mexican restaurant.
Yeah,
went to school, like got involved in computer programming. And then, like, literally changed your life.
Yeah, dude.
Dude, that is so... And then not only that, dude, like, you didn't even graduate high school. Like, you have to be some kind of genius, though, dude. Because, like, I think it's just because I think people that don't graduate high school and then go on it to succeed in life, it literally is because you're forced to learn things you don't want to learn, right? It doesn't have nothing to do with like your intelligence. It has to do with like people telling you, you have to learn this, and this curriculum. And you're like, I don't want to learn that. I want to learn this.
Yeah.
Right? What do you think that was?
I think that makes sense. I think that's a lot of my like problem in life is I don't like being told what to do. and I get extremely suspicious of someone telling me what to do. I have like I have extreme resistance towards it. I don't know what it is. Parents typically tell their children they don't have respect, but I really don't. I have like nearly zero respect for nearly anyone. I mean, I respect people I meet. I have a base level of respect, but I don't have enough respect for someone to allow them to tell me what to do. Like that is never I've accepted, and it's maybe a problem why I've never really felt comfortable in a job
it probably comes from like you just because I feel like that way too, right?
Yeah,
like it has nothing to do with like what they're saying is wrong or anything. It's just like, no, I don't want to do it like that. I want to do it like this.
Yeah.
And that's all it is. Like, I don't even think their position is wrong or anything. It's probably right. It's just that I just know better. And I think my way is going to be the better approach.
Yeah.
And
yeah. So I think that's true. I think it's just, you know, like you don't know what my goal in my life is to get what I want. Like my goal in my life is to do the things I want, to have the experiences I want, whatever. And how does someone who hardly knows me or hardly cares about me, they don't know what I want and how to get it, and they have like no context. And so in some cases this is harmful because someone is giving you genuinely good advice and you don't follow it. But that's really, I think, the crux of it is like, these people don't know what the fuck you want. Like, and they don't know how you're supposed to get it in a way that preserves things that are valuable to you.
Yeah. Out the gates, towards heaven. Got the mayor. Jeez.
Yeah.
So many people. So you said that you were taking mushrooms. What did you see?
Oh,
do you see things? Or is it more like you feel things? Or is it more like...
It's kind of both.
I'm always interested in like music. Does music sound better? Or is it more of like a...
I wonder if we can find it. There should be a conference room, maybe. More options. I don't know. It's mostly Coke and Zevia. I'm kind of a topo guy.
Let me get one of these. Get one of these, yeah. I can't believe they're giving out this stuff for free.
Well, it's not free.
That's crazy. Well, you got that golden ticket, so...
Yeah, I got it for free. don't tell anyone, but I actually searched through the swag bags to find the golden ticket.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I didn't
actually. Okay, we'll leave that out.
We might be able to go in this room here. I don't know if there's a conference room here we can use. I'm usually on the 8th floor. Yeah, why don't we just hang out in this room?
Yeah, until somebody kicks us out.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
So these are real things that happen, where you can apply these important concepts and understand that when we lose our connection to nature, we lose our spirit, our humanity, our sense of self.
Talking about the mushroom trip, my friend Doug, he studied fine art, and he painted this painting that was sitting in the room, and it's this abstract painting. It's kind of this crazy image, and so I was looking at this image, and then I had been thinking a lot about like entropy, like the physics concept of entropy, like this thermodynamic concept, and I was getting a lot of visualizations of like the universe. You know, what it means. Like, one of the big messages I got is like the real war of life is a war on entropy, is a war on, you know, losing order, basically. As life is like anti-entropy, it's creating order from disorder. It's concentrating order. It's concentrating basically meaning. And any organization, we're bringing like form to things that wouldn't otherwise have them. And yeah, or I don't know, arguably, you know, before we had DNA, before we had life, there were just molecules. Like, we had it was very simple, like almost more, you can argue more disordered kind of situation, even though, you know, life creates its own disorder. Life is kind of a more ordered form of molecules. It's like a higher level order. But that was like kind of what I was left with in that trip, was like, the goal is to create order. The goal is to create, and in order to, you know, you create more life, you help life, you push life forward as much as you can. Really, that's what you want to be doing. Was kind of the message I was left with, which is kind of the way I was living before. But it was nice to have like some articulation of it and some kind of imagery, like more or less implanted in my brain by the experience.
All of those kind of experiences influence you, or when you're coding, or when you're building things? Or do you think it's more of kind of like a subliminal thing, or it's just like, it's just, or you think that, or do you not think about those things?
I mean, they definitely, those kind of experiences do. I mean, I think they push me towards more things that I think are more like supportive of like more life, more things that are, I guess, more, you know, could potentially be more meaningful in terms of like propelling things forward. Like I had a friend who was telling me about a job opportunity he had recently, because the company just worked for IPO'd, and so he's coming to some money, and then he was talking to another company that was just getting started, And they were trying to build a team, and I'm like, so what do they do? And he's like, it's commercial insurance. And I'm like, oh.
It sounds fascinating. And then you say commercial insurance, yeah, and I'm like,
oh my God, that's so boring. Like, what is that? I mean, it's providing value for people. That's why they're able to make money doing something like that. But it's like, it's not really...
It's not fundamentally changing the world for the better, right?
Yeah, you're making this thing that people value at the margins who are already perhaps wealthy or already well off, and you're making it incrementally better for them, and you're capturing the value of that. It's like, it's just kind of a boring... I just wouldn't feel great about spending my time that way. And so, yeah, so there's like... But I felt this way for a long time, even before like a trip like this. But it has become more important as I've gotten like older and had more of these experiences, like where I want to keep moving towards things where my values are aligned and I'm like expressing not only my like creativity or whatever, but I'm expressing my values. I'm trying to push my values out into the world. And like bolster them or support them as much as I can.
It's like you're trying to move the world in the direction that you know can impact the most people in a profound way, but also be happy waking up every day and like, and like feeling good about yourself, but also like maintain like a beautiful and happy life and still make money doing it. But it doesn't need to be a lot of money. It just needs to be enough money to support yourself, right?
Yeah, and a family or depending on what else.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think that's like a beautiful thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're in a fortunate time where that's actually in a fortunate time and place in the United States where that's actually possible, where we actually have things are cheap enough in certain respects. Certain things are cheap enough. Certain things have out competed inflation and gotten actually cheaper over time to the point where, you know, food is relatively inexpensive and abundant. A lot of natural resources even are quite cheap. And even though there are tons of problems with these things and, you know, people suffering as a result of them, they're still, on our receiving end of them, they're cheap and abundant. And so it enables us to have a little more freedom. And some people, I think, are still trapped in the idea of they need to consume as much as possible, even though they can meet their base level needs fairly simply. Like I was maybe, when I was working, the company I last worked for, I was spending maybe 10% of my total income. Like I was spending very little money, and I just didn't need it. It was like a really silly thing. I was just like accumulating all of this money, and I was like, what do I even need? Well, like I want it because it's going to help me be a little more free. But other than that, like I just feel purposeless and like, yeah. But that's kind of a long, there's really not a career in that. I always say if like once AI takes over programming or something, then I can go back to oil painting.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
I'm never gonna understand.
Tell me about Stacker News.
Yeah.
How did it start? How did you envision it? Because it was funny, like, when we met, it was kind of weird. Like,
yeah.
We literally met at this meetup, and we won't go into specifics about it. But we literally met this meetup. Like, I think you had went up first, and like, you had been like, my name's Keyan, I'm from Austin, I'm a developer. And I was like, wow, who's this guy? I've never heard of him before. He's from Austin. I was like, I'm gonna be friends with this dude. He doesn't even know it. Like, that was running through my head. And then you sat down, and I was like, hey, I'm from Austin too. I went up there right after you, and I was like, hey, I'm from Austin too. And you were like, whoa, what is this dude saying? Why is he pointing at me? You had that look in your face. And I was, and then
I was
like,
I think we had, from the conference.
And then like, we had talked afterwards. And then I saw you at Austin BitDevs, and I think we had both started talking then.
Yeah.
And then like, lo and behold, like, I think it was like a month later, I saw that you had released Stacker News, but I don't even know if it had gotten released well before that. But I remember you telling me that you were working on it.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking like, wow, that's such a great idea. Like, that's going to be really, 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 really good and needed in our space. So like, tell me about how you came up with the idea, and like, tell me about like how it's going, and like how you built it, and who's helping, and like everything. Yeah.
So what had happened is I moved to Austin in like January of this year, and I went to a bit dev. So I was already into Bitcoin in like 2016. We went through that already. But I went to this bit devs, and I had this incredible feeling of like, I need to learn as much as I possibly can about Bitcoin. I more or less fell in love with Bitcoin at that point. I was already into Bitcoin, but I hadn't had the moment yet where I wanted to dedicate my life to it. But something about that meetup and something about Bitcoin generally, it has a very weird feeling to it. When you get involved, I mean, I don't know what it is, but there's like an inevitability that you feel. And one of the things that I remember saying after I went to this meetup is, it was a lot like a Halt and Catch Fire episode. I don't know if you've seen that.
Yeah, I love that show.
That's what it felt like to me. When I was at this meetup, there were people, it just felt like we were...
on the cutting edge?
We were on the edge of something. We were being... I'm losing my words, but we were being subversive. And people there were misfits in the best way. Like, I consider myself a misfit, and I felt like I was among misfits of their... Exactly. Misfits of their own kind. And it felt like we were doing something that was important, that certain people wouldn't want us to do. And there's something so cool about that. And I think it has to feel like what the early internet felt like. And so that was, you know, so you have this pattern matching where you're like, this is what something important probably feels like. Like, I've read enough about the early internet and early computers to know that's how these people felt. And I started feeling this way about Bitcoin. And so I was like, all right, I'm going to go full in on Bitcoin. I'm going to drop everything else I'm doing, and this is it now. This is what I'm going to do. And so I was like, all right, so if I'm going to learn, if Bitcoin is the most important thing and I want to learn about it as much as I can, the best thing I can do is just build something, because that's how I learn. Is when I actually interact with it, that's when I can get confident about what its actual features are, how it works, that kind of stuff. And I'm not like just regurgitating information I know. Like, I'm beginning to actually, I have to, like, in order for a program to work on top of something, you have to know actually how it works. And it's like you meaningfully know. And so, yeah, I was like, I'm gonna build something. But you know, there's this startup mantra, like, you know, build things you want, like scratch your own itch. So it's like, I'm gonna build something. It's gonna have to be something I want. And it's going to involve Bitcoin. And so I went, I think it was the next meetup I went to, and I was talking to Ben the Carman. We were like walking somewhere, and I was like walking next to him, and I was, I was talking about, like, how do I learn more? I was asking him, how do I learn more about Bitcoin? Like, what do I, like, there's so much information. It's like a fire hose online. I come to these meetups, I love it, because I get all this technical information and I get caught up. And in contrast to something like Twitter, which tends to have a lot of shit posting and stuff, and there's a lot of like arguments and interactions with no coiners and a variety of other types that tend to encroach on the area. And then on Reddit, you have a lot of more kind of similar poor discourse. Like, it tends to be very price focused, lots of no coiners, lots of low quality contributions in terms of conversations. So what I was trying to do was, like, I found these meetups so great. I wanted to create a meetup. I wanted to basically, how do I make something like this online? And it was convenient that Bitcoin has this native way to make payments online on the internet, because really what makes an in-person interaction great and usually productive is that you have these reputational incentives in a social interaction. Like, you don't say something horrible to someone because, you know, you're now going to be less welcome in a social situation later, or, you know, other people are going to tell other people about that or whatever. So you have like these inbaked incentives that perhaps even like evolved in humans to be productive and good. And when you're online, that those aren't present, they're gone. But so with Bitcoin, I had this idea, like, you have this incentive mechanism. Like, you can import into an application now this like economic structure of incentives to perhaps encourage more productive conversation. And so that's kind of what it was. Like, I'm gonna build a Hacker News like site, because I love Hacker News, and I'm going to make it better by wrapping it in Bitcoin and Lightning.
And I think everybody in that room feels the same way. And there's like 100 something people in that room.
Yeah.
That feels like that.
Yeah. They're all over the place. I mean, it's not just in that room. I did this Chain Code Labs seminar, this Lightning seminar. I met a guy who was prior to Bitcoin, he was doing stand-up comedy, and then he got enamored with Bitcoin. His name is Sahar, really, really cool, nice guy. And he got enamored with Bitcoin. He did a code boot camp, and now he's like, you know, pursuing Bitcoin instead of stand-up. Because he's like, I feel like Bitcoin is the future. And he's like, I'm going to live in the future. And I feel like, you know, stand-up has maybe some problems right now, or I shouldn't speak for him, but like, yeah, he just got into Bitcoin. I mean, people see these kinds of things, and it's like the shared conviction of everyone that you meet, and how diverse the backgrounds are. It's incredible. Like, it's hard to imagine, you know, nothing comes of this. It just feels so inevitable.
You're so passionate about this, and I'm just as passionate as you, like, how passionate so many others are. Like, and we're all doing different things, and it's not weird, but it is kind of weird how we all fundamentally feel the same thing. Like, that's so cool. So tell me about the website. Tell me how it's going, like, day to day. Like let's get geeky for the Lightning kids out there who are going to like want to know like some of the back end stuff. Like, if you had to, who are probably you in January who are going to need to like who are going to need some help on like how you came up with the idea, like where to go.
Yeah, how do you build like a something like a Lightning powered application. Yeah. So it's fairly So you need a node. I run a node on AWS. I have a node at home, but I also run this one on AWS. It's from Lightning Labs. I use their daemon or daemon. I never know which way to pronounce it. But I use LND for my Lightning node, and it's backed by Bitcoin D. And then Alex Bosworth, who does a bunch of great work on Lightning and is like one of the many like great champions, like Ryan Gentry, in the Lightning space. He wrote a little JavaScript library that kind of wraps the calls that you make to the daemon, the LND application. And so I interact with the Lightning network through that in my application. And then the site is somewhat, it has a custodial Bitcoin kind of service. I hope in the future to have non-custodial. But I'm really on Stacker News right now. We're dealing with mostly what is called dust on the network. So amounts that are so small, you wouldn't actually want to transact with them across the Lightning network, because you would never want to go on chain with the amounts because they're so small. Like if I'm sending, you know, one Satoshi across the network and it costs me 100 to maybe resolve a dispute about this one Satoshi getting sent, I'm not going to do it. So you effectively have a possibility of losing that. So custodial solution kind of makes sense in this context. So we have a custodial Bitcoin, or you have like a wallet on Stacker News, which is kind of, you know, your balance that you can spend down and your balance that grows if you contribute content that is like valuable to other people. You know, so that uses Lightning invoices, and you can deposit money and you can withdraw money. I also use LN URL auth, which is this cool kind of URL scheme that allows people to authenticate their identity using their Lightning node rather than an email address or GitHub or Twitter, which is really, most people are super enamored with that aspect. And it was really simple to implement given all the work that other people have done, but people love the shit out of that.
That's really cool. I love using my Twitter just because it was just like so much easier, and I could take my handle with me. Like, that was freaking awesome.
Yeah. So there's like that. So LN URL is kind of like that, but you get to use your Lightning node. And so it's kind of something similar.
So what are you going to do when Jack Dorsey buys you?
Yeah, I guess, you know, Lambo.
Are you going to tell him no? Because you're used to telling people no?
Yeah, I definitely wouldn't. I don't think I'd sell. I mean, if I'm going to sell to anyone, it'd probably be Jack Dorsey. But yeah, I don't. Would he buy? He probably wouldn't buy.
He probably wouldn't buy. He'd probably just like fund you, I would imagine. He'd probably just say, hey, let's throw more resources at it. But that's something you could implement into like Twitter, right? Like, couldn't it be implemented into like a bigger platform or no?
He's talked about it. Yeah, definitely. People see this. So people see, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how much of an, I don't know if they've seen Stacker News or we just have like this parallel ideation going on, but Jack Dorsey sees the potential in like the incentive structures that you can kind of layer on top of social interactions online using something like Bitcoin. I watched a talk from I watched a talk from Vitalik because I'm curious about what's going on in the Ethereum ecosystem.
Yeah,
and he basically described Stacker News.
He's ripping you off or what?
No, I don't think he's ripping. I don't think he's probably.
Dude, they totally are probably ripping you off.
I don't know.
Right,
I don't,
now as we speak.
Maybe, but he shared a similar idea on stage at like whatever Ethereum conference he was talking at, where he's like, I believe we can create a social network where we import these incentive mechanisms into it. And then he also talked about Ethereum login on such a service, which we have this like Lightning login thing on the service. So it's you know, I don't want to say that there's any like idea stealing going on. My like default position will be that it's like there's like a lot of parallel ideas going on. Like, I didn't think it's a it's fairly obvious to someone who gets involved in the space that this is true of Bitcoin.
It actually makes more sense on Lightning, and I'll tell you why. Satoshis are going to be worth a lot in the future. If right now, like, I'm burning through Satoshis on your website, and I'm like, the more and more I think about it, the more I'm like, I'm going to really hate myself in the future. Yeah. But that's okay, because it's for a good cause.
But hopefully we'll have better ways for you to earn more in the future.
But I'm okay with it. Because, I think I put, 10,000 Satoshis to start off with. And, it's really cool. And it's addicting, too. And I'm just going to share this with you.
Yeah.
The fact that you threw lightning bolts in there was all I needed for it to be addicting. I don't know if you thought about you did think about that.
Yeah. Okay.
So you thought about what is the, what do they call that when it gives you the
dopamine?
Dopamine. There you go. Did you think about dopamine and that it causes you? Because I feel like when I click on things, I'm like, give me that dopamine, give me that lightning bolt. And that's what it does for me.
Yeah.
So you thought about that.
Yeah, definitely that you would get like a little emotional bump when you would click that button. Like that was definitely something I thought, because you want to delight. Like part of what you're doing when you're creating anything is you want someone to feel like something special. And what you do that by creating these like little experiences. And that was definitely why I had the lightning bolt, is I wanted someone to feel like this is different and special, and this person is really trying to make me feel good. And so that's why the lightning bolt is there, because I know it would tickle me, and so I know it's gonna tickle.
I'm definitely getting tickled, dude. Every time I'm like hitting the lightning bolts, like I'm definitely not like, because I'll throw a post there, and sometimes I throw my own post for my own podcast stuff, but most of the time I'll throw like other just good posts that I see, you know? And I'll post it on there and I'll hit the dopamine, or not dopamine, I'll hit the lightning bolt.
Yeah.
But then I'll hit it a couple times. But I do it not just because I'm trying to boost myself up to the top, but I do it just because it's addicting, right?
Okay. Yeah, I didn't realize it would be that. It would be like that.
It's like addicting to like see the lightning bolt go over and over.
Yeah.
So then I was thinking, I was like, man, it'd be cool if you could turn it to dark, like a dark mode, and then just see if it's in the dark, it'd be cool to in my room, it's all dark. The screen is all dark, and then just see lightning bolts crash down.
Yeah.
That would be cool as hell.
Yeah. Definitely a dark mode with lightning would be cool.
That'd be epic if this is just me getting crazy, but that'd be cool. You just keep hitting the lightning bolt, and then after so many lightning bolts, just like a thunder, I don't know if that could even be done, but I'm just thinking of I'm just thinking of wow, dude, the fact that you kind of put that kind of effect in there, I was always wondering, I was like, did Keyan actually think about the whole dopamine effect to that, and did he read up on it, and what creates that?
Yeah, so I'm definitely aware of these experiences being important when you're building a product, because you want to be remarkable. So that's really what you're trying to do when you're creating anything that you want to encourage other people to feel, to have feelings towards and share with other people, is you want it to be worth commenting on to someone else. And so part of that is creating these little delightful moments that's why a UI is more important than I think a lot of programmers give credit to it. There's a reason why Umbral has probably contributed to massive success on the Lightning Network. It's because it you feel good when you're using it. It feels delightful. They have all of these little cute animations, and there's shadows and all of these things, and it's better. It's better. Yeah, it's important.
It makes you proud to run a node, I guess. And it's no offense against some of these other ones that are doing exceptional work.
Yeah.
But it's just difficult for people that are everyday users, right? That don't understand it.
We all love pretty things. I mean, it's silly to imagine we don't. All of us want, our partner to be perhaps not, we do want them to be physically attractive, but we want them to be attractive in a variety of ways. We want things to be as good as they possibly can be. There's no question about it. So anyone who says, this aspect of the product doesn't matter is wrong. I mean, it matters to someone,
Yeah, it should have some kind of you're right.
Yeah, everything is important to someone. And people are very visual. People love, and
Yeah, I think you hit it out of the park, dude. I'm such a fan of that website. I haven't gone on today to check it out, what's on there, but I'm even getting some good content. Like I'm seeing what people are posting, and I feel like I'm getting some really good content just in news in general. So
yeah, that's great. And it was in the Bitcoin OpTech newsletter. So people are interested and aware of it. I think, you know, the big problem with these kinds of things are, you know, you need to get like a critical mass of community on it. So that's kind of, I think most people see the potential in it, and but they're waiting for, you know, there are certain people who come before the critical mass, and they're like the early adopters, and they care before they see potential way before other people, and will stick it out until they love being there early before that critical mass forms. And so that's who we have on the site right now. But I think there are some other people that are waiting for more activity to be there. So my background doing these things for a long time, like the most important things are like talking to customers. So talking to users, like making sure you have an open dialogue with them. So I've been trying to form ways of doing that, and then shipping cadence. So like those are the main determinants of success in terms of input. And you can't, you know, if you have something that people want, that those will get you towards an output that people truly want. So that's really what I'm going to be focusing on, is like delivering as many features as I possibly can, and meaningful features, you know, that are, if someone commented recently that I shouldn't be adding too many features, I should be mostly refining features. And I think that's true too. So focusing on intelligent features, but mostly just trying to deliver things that delight users as much as possible, as fast as possible.